Hallelujah. Psalms 100. Let's go to Psalms 100 this morning as we begin this morning service. It says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know he that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gate with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his holy name. For the Lord, he is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth to all generation. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come before your throne today, we acknowledge that you are the Prince of Peace, you are the Rose of Sharon, the Lilies of the Valley, the Bright and the Morning Star. You are El Shaddai, Al Elohim, the one who said to Moses, when you go to Pharaoh, say to him, the I am that I am has sent me. The name, the God at which every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that you are God. And so as we come this morning, we come the God presenting ourselves before you. We come this morning where every tongue will confess that you are God. We come confessing that you are the one and only God. And as Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There is no other way but by and through Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, as we come, we acknowledge Father this morning. We acknowledge the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. And we pray, thee, God, that the presence of God will move. We pray that your Holy Spirit will come and sup with us this morning. We pray that the Holy Spirit will come, the God, and as we worship, it will be a sweet fragrance before you. It will be as perfume before you this morning, God, that it will be pleasing in your sight. It will bring satisfaction, the God, as you encounter the worship of your children, of your sons and your daughters who have come into your house to ascribe worth unto you, recognizing that you are worthy of it all. Not some, but you are worthy of it all this morning, oh God. And so this morning we have come that we might give you praise, glory and honor and adoration. We have come that we can exalt you this morning. We have come to declare that you are alive and well. There are kings that are elected. There are presidents who are elected, but you forever sit upon the throne. And so, Lord, this morning we worship you. This morning we exalt you, God. We pray that even as the worshipers come, the God, to lead us into the holies of holies, that we have an expectation of your presence this morning. We have an expectation of the move of the Holy Spirit in this place. As the word go forth, oh God, may it accomplish that which it has set forth to accomplish this morning. And so, Lord, have your way this morning as we worship you, the God, not with our lips, but from the depths of our hearts. And so, Lord, to you be all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together for the Lord this morning.
Hallelujah. Bless your name, Lord. God, we magnify you. We thank you. Good morning, Ebenezer.
Good morning.
How's everyone doing this morning?
Good.
Great to see your beautiful faces. This morning's going to be a little bit different since we don't have our musicians with us today, but you know what I love? I love that we have internal instruments. Yes. Amen? So we have our voices, we have our hands that we can clap, we have our bodies that we can move and praise the Lord with.
Amen.
Anybody with me this morning?
Yes.
So whether you have a tambourine or whether you just have your hands, we're going to invite you to worship the living God with us this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Just begin to lift up your voice. Bless your name. Hallelujah. Lord, you are worthy to be praised. Has he done anything for you this week? Has he brought you through another week? Brought you through another day? Is he keeping you moment by moment? Hallelujah. We bless your name, Lord. We glorify you. We lift you up, Lord. Hallelujah to your holy name. Hallelujah. We give you the highest praise, Lord. We magnify and thank you. Hallelujah. We bless your name, God. You are good. You are good. You are good. The song says, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. And if you've come into this building to worship with others around you, just lift up your voice and bless the name of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made.
I will
rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Come on, say it again.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise.
I will say
this is the day that the Lord has made.
I will
rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Say, he has made me glad.
He has made me glad.
Yeah, yeah.
He has made me glad.
I will
rejoice, for he has made me glad.
He has
made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Come on, I will enter.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise.
Come on, I will say
this is the day that the Lord has made.
I will
rejoice, for he has made me glad.
He has made me glad, say.
He has made me glad.
Yeah, yeah.
He has made me glad.
Y'all sound good.
I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
He has
made me glad.
Yeah.
He has made me glad.
I will
rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Everybody say, this is the day.
This is the day.
This is the day.
This is the day.
That the Lord.
That the Lord has made.
That the Lord.
That the Lord has made.
Come on, I will rejoice.
I will rejoice.
I will rejoice
and be glad in it. And be glad in it.
Come on, say,
this is the day.
This is the day.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Come on, sing it like you mean it. Say,
this is the day.
This is the day.
This is the day.
This is
that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made.
I will rejoice.
I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it.
Look at somebody and say,
this is the day that the Lord has made.
I will rejoice
and be glad in it.
This is the day
that the Lord has made.
One more time, I will enter
his gates with thanksgiving in my
heart. Come on,
I will enter his courts with praise.
Say, I will say
this is the day that the Lord has made.
I will
rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Come on, tell somebody, he has made me glad.
He has made me glad.
Yeah, yeah.
He has made me glad.
I will
rejoice, for he has made me glad.
He has
made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
He has made me glad.
He has
made me glad. He has made me glad.
I will
rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Yep.
He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Bless your name, Lord.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you. I don't care if there's music or not to accompany me. I will bless the name of the Lord at all times. And his praise shall continually be in my mouth. Hallelujah. We bless your name. Hallelujah. The song says, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
Come on, say that again. Say, Lord.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I sing your praises.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
In my life.
I'm so glad you came to save
Hallelujah.
us.
You came
from heaven to earth
to show us all.
My debt
to pay.
From the cross to the grave.
From the grave
to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift
your name on high.
I lift your name, on high.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
We sing your praises.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
Thank you, Lord, for being in our lives.
I'm so glad you came to save us.
Come on, you came.
You came from heaven
to earth.
To show the way.
From the earth
to the cross.
My debt you paid.
My debt you paid.
From the cross.
From the cross to the grave.
From the grave
to the sky. Lord, I lift your name.
Show us the way
from the earth
to the cross.
Hallelujah. My debt you paid.
From the cross
to the grave.
From the grave
to the sky.
Lord, I lift
your name on high.
You came. Hallelujah. Those voices sound so beautiful.
Hallelujah.
I pray that as we're singing these songs, that we are worshiping the audience of one. Hallelujah, Lord. We magnify you. We're going to head to a hymn. Great is thy faithfulness. Hallelujah. Bless your name. Bless your name. I want to read the second verse. Or is it the third verse? Just read it so we can hear it and meditate on those words. It says, a pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. I just want to encourage us today that we have strength for today from the living God.
Amen.
And not just for today, but a hope for tomorrow.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. If you don't have anything to praise Hallelujah. The Lord for, praise him for that. The strength that we have today, because we have another day where we walked into a building to bless his name. We've walked in here together to lift him up, to open up our mouths and give him praise. And it's only because of his mercies that we are not consumed. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. There's a little feedback on my mic. Can we fix that, please? Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou
Lord, unto me pardon.
Thank you, Lord, for your goodness.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for your mercies.
Hallelujah.
New every morning.
Thank you, Father.
New every morning.
Thank
Great
you.
Is your faithfulness,
Thank you,
Lord, unto us.
Thank
hallelujah,
you,
hallelujah.
Thank
we bless your name, Lord.
Hallelujah.
We magnify
oh,
your name,
we
Lord.
Worship and adore.
Just think about
for
one thing the Lord has done for you.
Thank you.
Just think about one
Thank
thing
you,
the Lord
Father.
Has brought you through.
Thank you, Father.
Just think
Thank
about
you.
One way that the Lord
Thank
has
you,
made.
God. Hallelujah.
Just think about
Hallelujah.
One way
Hallelujah.
That the Lord has Hallelujah. Made. Hallelujah. We bless your name, Lord. We thank you. We glorify you. Thank you for keeping us, O Lord. Thank you for your strength. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your grace, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is your faithfulness morning by morning. Hallelujah, Lord.
We glorify you.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you,
Great
God.
Is your
Hallelujah.
Name.
We bless Hallelujah. Your name.
Father, we magnify,
magnify you. Hallelujah.
We
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You, Father God.
Hallelujah.
Who is like unto you? There is no one like you.
Hallelujah, Lord.
We give you praise.
Great is your faithfulness.
Be thou glorified.
Hallelujah.
Be glorified.
Bless your
Be
name,
glorified.
Lord. Hallelujah.
You are worthy of praise.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory and honor belongs to you, Father.
Hallelujah.
God. Glory and honor.
Hallelujah.
Belongs.
Hallelujah.
Glory and honor.
Great
belongs.
Is your faithfulness.
Great is your faithfulness.
Great is your
Great
faithfulness,
is your
Lord.
Faithfulness, Father
Great
God.
Is your
we
faithfulness,
give you praise.
Lord.
Hallelujah.
Bless your name,
Hallelujah.
Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Just before pastor comes up with the word. Just want to again welcome each and every single one of us as we've gathered together again to worship the name of the living God. Whether you're watching via live stream or in this building, God bless you. I pray that something said today will encourage you, whether it's a smile from somebody that will encourage you. God bless you. And he is blessing us and he is keeping us. Hallelujah, Lord. Just turn to someone and say, hello, good morning. Is it still morning? Yes, we haven't reached 12 yet. Good morning. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Hallelujah. And we have a couple of visitors with us this morning. We just want to welcome you and say thank you for being in our presence this morning. And we pray that the presence of the Lord has already been blessing you and will continue to keep you. You are welcome to come at any time. Our doors are open.
Amen.
Will anyone around them just give them a smile, a handshake, and let them know that they are welcome, whether they're behind you or in front of you. Bless your name, God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Pastor's coming with the word. Prepare our hearts, prepare our minds. Amen.
Than that. Can you just stand to your feet and move around? I don't know why people are sitting in their seats this morning. I know we have some visitors. Can the visitors just give us a wave? Can somebody please just go to our visitors and give them a hug, a welcome into Ebenezer? Just welcome our visitors this morning. Amen. And our visitor this morning is, if I'm correct, she's all the way from Queens visiting us this morning. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Yes, I love you with the love of the Lord. Yes, I love you with the love of the Lord. For I can see in you the glory of the King. And I love you with the love of the Lord. Oh, yes, I love you with the love of the Lord. Oh, yes, I love you with the love of the Lord. For I can see in, thanks so much, the glory of the King. And I love you with the love of the Lord. Oh, greet somebody in Jesus' name. Would you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Greet somebody in Jesus' name. Would you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. If there's no one else that loves you this morning, just know Jesus does. If no one loves you this morning, just know that Jesus does. Amen. If no one ever said, I love you, know that Jesus does. That's the one person that we can count on this morning. Hallelujah. 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 Let's just put our hands for the Lord this morning. Amen. It's good to be in the presence of the Lord this morning. In the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. Let us stand as we read the word of God this morning that is taken from 1 Samuel chapter 16 from verses 1 to 13. First Samuel chapter 16 from verses 1 to 13. Amen. Just giving everyone a chance to find a word this morning. And the Lord said unto Samuel, how long wilt thou mourn for Saul? Brother, can you just turn down the volume a little? Thank you. Yes, 1 Samuel chapter 16 from verses 1 to 13. And the Lord said unto Samuel, how long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill thine horn with oil, and go, I will send thee to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided me a king among his sons. And Samuel said, how can I go? If Saul hear it, he will kill me. And the Lord said, take an heifer with thee, and say, I come to sacrifice to the Lord. And call Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show thee what thou shalt do. And thou shalt anoint unto me him whom I name unto thee. And Samuel did that which the Lord spake, and came to Bethlehem. And the elders of the town trembled at his coming, and said, comest thou peaceably? And he said, peaceably, I come to sacrifice unto the Lord. Sanctify thyself, and come with me to the sacrifice. And he sanctified Jesse and his sons, and called them to the sacrifice. And it came to pass, when they were come, that he looked on Eliab, and said, surely the Lord's anointed is before me. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on the countenance, or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him, for the Lord seeth not as man seeth. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, neither had the Lord chosen this. Then Jesse made Shammah to pass by. And he said, neither had the Lord chosen this. And Jesse made seven of his sons to pass before Samuel. And Samuel said unto him, the Lord had not chosen these. And Samuel said unto him, Jesse, are here all thy children? And he said, there remaineth yet the youngest, and behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he come hither. And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and withal of a beautiful countenance, and a godly to look to. And the Lord said, arise and anoint him, for this is he. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed in the midst of his brethren, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David, and from that day forward, so Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. This is the word of God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come before your throne today, God, I pray that as the word go forward, it will fall on good and fertile soil. It will accomplish that which it has set forth to accomplish this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, I pray it will uproot and pull down where it is needed, dear God. But at the same time, it will bring healing and restoration in the lives of your people. I pray that self will decrease and the Spirit of God will increase inside of me, and every word that is spoken is guided by the Spirit and the anointing of your presence. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. You may have your seats. God is good, and all the time Amanda, it doesn't sound like that at all. God is good. And all the time. Amen. Amen. And so I shared a little of this on Friday in our morning's devotion, but I just felt it strong in my heart that the Lord wanted this message to be shared this morning. And so I'm sharing with you the story of David being anointed. And the theme that I'm using is faithful in little, called to greatness. Faithful in little, but called to greatness. Can we just turn down the volume a little for me, please? Hallelujah. Yes, that's better. Thank you. And so as we read the word of God and we're taking it from the top, it says, "And the Lord said to Samuel, how long will thou mourn for Saul?" And one thing that God is acknowledging here is that Saul is not above God. And sometimes we can put people above God simply because of their stature, because of their status, because of the wealth. We put people above God. What Samuel failed to recognize that it was God who had instructed after the people asked for a king and gave permission for Saul to become king. So therefore, as God set up, he can also set down. And I want us to remember that, because sometimes we can believe that we're so holy and righteous and we're so educated and we are so there that we cannot be removed. And Bible has shown us that God can remove you voluntary or involuntary. So the first thing you must understand is the sovereignty of God. And when God speaks above the authority that men have. Many times we acknowledge the authority of men rather than acknowledging the authority that God has over men. And so God had to remind Samuel that it was him who put him there. And God said to him, "How long will thou mourn for this man that is no longer found favor in my sight?" And so Samuel, the Lord said to him, "I'm sending you somewhere, and I want you to go, and I will direct you to whom is to become king." The first thing we must understand is God's sovereignty this morning. And so I'm going to say what sovereignty means. Sovereignty of God in the biblical doctrine is that God is supreme ruler of the universe and has the right and power to do all things according to his own good pleasure. God is not limited or constrained by anything outside of himself. And he is complete control of all creation from eternity. Time does not confine him, but time is subject to him and his sovereignty. So whenever God decides to appoint and to separate, he does so liberally without the consent of man. God's sovereignty is based on his nature, his wisdom, his love, and the fact that he is limitless. Isaiah 49, 9 to 11, it says, "I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me. I make my own end from the beginning, from ancient time. What is still to come, I say. My purpose will stand and I will do all that I please. What I have said, I will bring about. What I have planned, that will I do." Romans 9 and 20. "But who are you, a human being, to talk to God? Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, 'What did you make me? Why did you make me like this?'" The word is very clear that God is sovereign and that will never change. And so Samuel had to understand that the God that he served is above Saul and anything that Saul can bring before him. Psalms 15 Psalms 115 says, our God is in heaven. He does all that pleases him. Job 42:1 says, I know that you can do all things, that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Proverbs 9:21, many are the plans in the mind of men, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will stand. Romans 8:28 says, and he know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are what? Called according to his purpose. So when God speaks, he is intentional and he has purpose in whatever he says. Whatever is written concerning you, it will be accomplished unless you stand in the way of that accomplishment. Because God's word is absolute and cannot be changed. Psalms 135 and verse 6 says, whatever the Lord pleases, he does in heaven and on earth, in the sea and all the deeps. Daniel 4:35 says, all the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, and he does according to his will among the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. None can stay his hand to say to him, what have you done? He is God. Isaiah 46:10. Declaring the end from the beginning, from the ancient times, not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will accomplish in purpose. Brothers and sisters, God is sovereign. And as we examine the story, we saw that Samuel was looking to man instead of looking to God. And mind you, Samuel is a prophet. Samuel is the mouthpiece of God. And even Samuel was tend to just lean to the human side of things. Brothers and sisters, we are all human. And there are those times that in that little twinkle of a moment, we can take our eyes off of God. And it is important that we do not take our eyes off of God. The feedback. Hallelujah. It's important that we do not take our eyes off of God. God is sovereign and he does as he please. Number two, as we look at verse 4-5, we would see that, same 1 Samuel chapter 16, yes, verse 4-5. And Samuel did which the Lord spake, and came to Bethlehem, and the elders of the town trembled at his coming, and said, comest thou peaceably? And he said, peaceably, I am come to sacrifice unto the Lord. Sanctify yourselves, and come with me to the sacrifice. And he sanctified Jesse and his sons, and called them to the sacrifice. I want you to understand that the elders trembled. Why did the elders tremble? Have you ever thought about it? You go sometimes to a place and people don't even want to see your countenance. There was something about Samuel. There was an anointing, even though Samuel had his faults, because he looked at Saul before looking at what God was saying to him. But there was a countenance and there was an integrity of Samuel that preceded him that the elders know. For Samuel to have come, it is no ordinary matter. Are you following me? So when God intervened, he intervened in the extraordinary. So they already know that in order for Samuel to come, it was either judgment or it has got to be something good. And so they trembled because they were unaware of whether it was something good or whether it was a prophetic word of God in judgment. And brothers and sisters, when we step into our workplaces, when we step into our homes, when you step on the train, when you step on the bus, there must be a countenance that when the enemy sees you, it's either to run or to submit. Samuel had an integrity that preceded him. You don't have to say that I'm a Christian, but your mere presence must say to someone, hey, this is not one to be trifled with. This is not one to be touched.
Amen.
That's right. Come on.
There was something about Samuel, but Samuel carried himself humbly and with dignity. Not because you speak in tongues and diverse tongues and you're prophetic and you're prophetic, apostolic, whatever title you hold, don't ever let it get to you. Because one of the things about Samuel that the word of God said was that Samuel is always humble.
Yeah.
And haughtiness precedes a man before he falls. Pride precedes a man before he falls. So don't ever allow your title, whether you're a doctor, reverend, a teacher, a bank manager, don't ever allow your title to precede you. Let the God you serve in the character of who I am as Kioma must precede me.
Amen. 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 Praise the Lord.
And we see as Samuel went, they paraded the seven sons in front of him. Samuel went obediently because Samuel's also concerned about Saul. Remember, Saul was getting to a place where Saul displeased the heart of God. That's why there was need for a new king. Because Saul no longer pleased the heart of God. But Samuel was mourning because of what he saw Saul did. And God had to remind him, I put up, I appoint, and I pull down. God may leave Saul to sit there. God may leave your boss to sit there. God may leave your supervisor to sit there. But it does not mean that your time and season has not come.
Amen.
It does not mean that there's not a purpose that is about to be fulfilled. Because Saul still sat on the throne while David was about to be anointed king.
Amen.
Faithful. In little, called to greatness. I need us to understand the concept this morning. You see, when Samuel went and he looked upon the countenance of the seven sons, they didn't look like me. They were strong, they were fair countenance, they were status and height, the Bible says. They looked the part, they walked the part, but inside they could not play the part. While men look at the external, God looks at the internal. And Samuel still, as he looked at them, he was still looking. Imagine the prophet. Listen to me. The prophet is looking at the sons, and as much as he has the prophetic and the apostolic, he could not determine which of them it was. Because when God decides to speak, he speaks at his own time and at his own pleasure and at his own leisure. He did not say to Samuel, this is what the son would be called. His name would be. He said nothing to him. He said, you go. And you know why God sent him? Because God wants to see if he would have walked in obedience. He did not know who he was going to. He did not know which of the sons. All he knew was that God sent him. Brothers and sisters, when God say go, go. It's not your thing to be like Jonah and say, but why am I going to Nineveh to preach the gospel, those hypocrites? And it's not your business. Your business is to walk in obedience. And obedience lines up with sacrifice. Because even when Samuel made the choice to go there, he's very much aware that if Saul hear of it, that Saul will kill him. If Saul heard that he was there, Saul already knew in order for Samuel to come, it has to be something. Just as how the elders would have feared in reverence, Saul would know the only time Samuel comes is to bring the word of God. Are you following me? The only time that Samuel comes to bring forth the prophetic is to say, thus says the Lord, because the mouthpiece is about to come. If there is turbulence, peace is here. And I want to say to you, when you step into your workplace and all torn my break loose, the boss could say, look, peace is here and peace is you. Amen. When you show up, even if there's a storm, they know there's about to be a calm. You know why? Because you are a reflection of God's might, power, and authority. And when God decides to speak, men have got to listen. Who is David? David was a simple shepherd boy, rejected, had no value, was not respected, was not visible, is not seen, might have been abused. Who was David? David had no value to men. You see, sometimes we look at men to find your value, when your value can only be found in God. Because God has already scripted what David would become. And are you listening to me? And we're looking at the world to tell us what value looks like, what integrity looks like, what success looks like, what destiny looks like, and they know nothing. Because they judge you based on your outward appearance. You may not look the part, you may not dress the part, you may not be educated, listen to me, you may not have been to school far, you might have finished at grade 6, or you might have finished at grade 9, you might have dropped out and don't got no CXC. Listen to me, brothers and sisters, that does not affect the purpose for your life. And some of you have lived lives where you feel rejected, you don't feel like you have value like someone else. Listen! God determines your value and your worth and your purpose. He was insignificant. Imagine in your own home, usually when you're the smallest, you are the one that everybody loved. This young man was rejected. You remember when he went to carry the food for his brothers when Goliath, and how they treated him? What are you doing? Why don't you go back, little boy? You know nothing. Because they were judging the man's stature and his rags. He didn't look the part in the eyes of men. But what did Jesus see? Jesus saw a David that when the lion came, he strangled it. When the bear came, he saw that with the little he had. And he never, you see, the thing, the problem with some of us is that when we do something, the world must know that we did it for somebody. The world must know what we did. The word of God said, what you do in secret, I shall reward you openly. In secret, he slayed the lion. In secret, he slayed the bear. And why his brothers did not see, his father did not hear, but there was a God that was looking down. There was a God who saw what was hidden in secret and rewarded openly. What is the little that God has placed in your hands? Like those with the talents, what have you done with the one talent that God has given you? Have you been faithful in the little that he can reward you with the much? Your giftings is not for you. No. Your gifting is tied to the purpose that God knitted you in your mother's womb for. Amen. What is the little? Right. What is the little? My grandmother and I used to clean the church. And she would say, listen, if you clean it, clean to the best of your ability. Right. When they come in, they must see the face in the floor. Back in the Caribbean, younger carpet is wood floor. She said, make sure they can see the face in the floor. But you do it with diligence and patience. Love what you do. I can tell you, I know my grandma. People come at all hours of the night. and come and collect her because something gone wrong. Whether somebody needs prayer, a marriage is about to break up, whatever the issue, they will come at all sorts of nights. And she will come back home and she will say nothing as she goes about you. There's none of your business what just happened.
Amen. Amen.
All you need to know is that God just won a battle. That's what she would say. Granny is where you went all night. Is now you come back. She said, none of your business. All you need to know, God just won a battle.
Yeah.
What she did was not for men to see and to acknowledge. It is only when my grandmother died that we hear people come and tell some stories. Indian people came, black people, and people came from distance and tell you some stuff. Those was what you, then is what we knew. What she was doing in the middle of the night when people come to her. 97 years old, no sugar, no diabetes. When she make one cup of tea, you can make four cups of tea with it. That's so much sugar is inside. And nothing was wrong. You're laughing? Listen to me. When she make one cup of tea, you see when we have harvest, Thanksgiving, and she make one, she said she's making one bucket of drink, everybody said that's going to do because they know they can get two buckets from it. But she will sit and she will drink it. And at 97, no sugar, no diabetes. My grandmother had nothing. All she did was that she sat down, she had her tea, and she told my mom, I think the pipe running. By the time my mom going to turn off the tap and come back, she was gone peacefully. You see, many times when we do the things like David did, we want people to know that we just slay a lion. We want people to know we just slay a bear. We want people to know that I just helped Sister Green pay off her mortgage, or she was in a jam and I helped.
Yes. So true.
When you do that, know this, we all have got greatness on us. But it's the things that we do that compromise what is there. God does not remove it. And so when you begin to boast about what you have done for someone else, you begin to compromise your call to greatness. God does not do anything. I remember one thing Nelson Mandela said to me. In 2004, I had the privilege of meeting him in Soweto, South Africa. And he said one thing. He said, listen to me. Nothing stands in a man's way of his destiny but himself. He said, all of us are called, but it's the things that we do that compromises our spirituality and who we are that causes it to change. Not God, it is us. And David understood that what he did was not for his father. If I'm a shepherd, I'm going to be the best shepherd there is. I don't care if anybody else doesn't see, but no sheep is going to die on my watch. And if you have that intention when you help someone, not to be seen or to be heard, but that person is to be seen and heard, you are listening in. So we saw the one who was insignificant become the one who pleases the heart of God. If you believe this morning that you are the insignificant, that's what men say. It's not what God says. God does not see that when it comes to you. He sees someone of value. He sees someone who is strong. He saw someone who is dedicated. He saw someone who was willing to serve animals. If this man can save all of his animals, much less what he would do for a human being. You need to understand the little brings out the character that reflects the greater that God is calling you to. And if you can reflect the character in the little, how you expect to reflect it in the greater? God is a practical God. And he said all things work together for good for those who love and fear him. But he said what? Walk. Who are called and walk according to his purpose. Don't go quoting the scripture that all things work. No, there's a last part that all of us sometimes forget. You've got to walk according to his purpose. And if you walk according to his purpose, then it works out for your good. So don't go and tell people, oh, all going to work together for good and all blessings going to turn into curse and all of that. Listen to me, you got to be in God's purpose to experience the extraordinary. Because the ordinary is what men do. The extraordinary is what God is capable of.
Amen.
How do we see ourselves? Do we walk around feeling insignificant when we're among people? Do we see someone else because they can preach and they can pray? You know, where do I stand? You cannot compare your anointing to someone else's. Your anointing is your anointing and it is separate. And you have got the same reward that I have got, which is eternity. My award don't look different from yours. It is the same. Whether I'm a pastor, whether I'm a cleaner, secretary, or deacon, the reward is the same. It's to be in heaven with God. So it doesn't matter what role you play once you fulfill the purpose God has called you to. And too many times we're looking at other people and no, you can't compare other persons to you. You must understand, what is God saying to me? What value does God? I can ask the world for those values. Because today all of them will like you on Facebook and tomorrow something happened. It was just about time before that happened. But this is the God that I serve. Because even when David messed up, God still walked with him. God still talked with him. Can we have a church that when Sister Tessa mess up, I say, Sister, listen, it is done with it. It's done. How do we move forward now? How can I walk with you to ensure that you're redeemed and you are restored? That's why David had the relationship with God. Because even when God pointed out what he did wrong, God still walked with him. And we must understand that even when God has called us to purpose, yes, you may slip and slide, but you have a God that still walks with you. You are not alone. Because when he calls you, he takes full responsibility when he calls you. He don't call you and leave you hanging. He told Samuel, go do a sacrifice and invite the sons of Jesse. And bless them, sanctify them, and then I will show you who will be king. God walks with you and he talks. But sometimes we are too caught up with hearing all the voices and not the voice of the Holy Spirit. We are allowing people to define you. No. David became anointed as king when he was about 13, 14. But it took 15 years before he became king. And so in those 15 years, what did he do? He still subject himself to Saul. He never said to Saul, you know what? Is I going to become king? He had no pride. He humbled himself because he understand that God looks at the heart of men and not the outward appearance. Yes, God got a promotion for you, but sit and serve humbly under your boss. I don't care whether they're racist, whether they don't like you. Don't matter what. Listen to me. Because at God's appointed time, Saul had to step down. God might have spoken a word in your life a few years ago. Don't think that it is missed. At the right time, just walk according to his purpose. At the right time, you will become king. But some of us are not patient enough to wait until that time come. David had the opportunity to kill Saul. And what he did? He didn't kill him. Not touch the Lord anointing. David understood the principle of the spiritual governs the physical, and he dare not interfere with the spiritual. You want to walk in purpose? Do not interfere with the spiritual. At your appointed time, you will be king. At your appointed time, you're going to be supervisor. At your appointed time, you're going to be married. At your appointed time, you're going to have children. At your appointed time, you'll have your house. At your appointed time, you'll have your car. Just be patient. Not because I see Sister Faye got a car, I want a car too, and I got to outdo she and buy a better car. A lot of us hanging we hot where it can't reach. You look good, you dress good. The Gucci and everything, and you're driving fancy car. But when you go home, no food on the table. And the thing is, no food on the table, but if I ask you to fast, it's a problem. You might as well fast since you got food on your table. But I want us to understand. I wanted to make it practical. There are many times we have our focus in the wrong places, brothers and sisters. Our focus must be on God. Whether you are the Samuel this morning or you are the David, there's a role for you to play in the expansion and the building of God's kingdom. And you must understand where God has placed you. If it's just to encourage someone, encourage them. I taught for 6 years, and there was a student who graduated from the grade 7 exam. You know, you do common entrance to go to CXC and high school. You know, the only time that he learned that his parents could not read and write was when he finished high school. He never knew. But every day he'd come home, what did you learn in school? And sometimes the mother would say, that don't sound right. And she don't even know whether it's right or wrong. She just saying that. And she did that when he graduated top school in Guyana. Then is when he learned that his mother and father could not read or write. I'm saying that for you to understand. If your ministry is encouragement, just encourage somebody. Don't matter what anyone else say about them. Just simply do it. I can encourage your son, and somebody else will come and encourage mine. That's how it works. Sometimes you're helping someone and you're trying to help your own child, and it's not working. Continue helping there. God will send a rescue. True, true, true. There's a place for Samuel and there's a place for David. Amen. This two distinct person, but fulfilling God's purpose. Samuel wasn't jealous of young David being anointed. He was just concerned about doing the will and the purpose of God. Amen. Brothers and sisters, if you are faithful in the little that God has given you, there is a call for greatness, and you will get there. And the call to greatness is purpose. Stop walking around feeling like you're not valuable. Stop walking around feeling like you're nothing. Listen to me. The disciples that God called were fishermen. And if you come from the Caribbean, you know fishermen smell when they come from the sea, they rank. I don't care how rank you rank this morning. God still sees a sweet fragrance. I don't care if you've been mining the sheep and you smell like goat and cow. God still see a sweet fragrance. Are you following me this morning? It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter where you've done. What God is concerned about is that now you are ready to say, Lord, here I am. You use me. Amen. Wherever you say, I will go. Whatever you say to do, I will do. It's no longer me, but Christ that lives inside of me. I don't care. Yes. The filth of yesterday. We're so worried about yesterday that we can embrace today and see tomorrow. The little God has given you, brothers and sisters, be faithful in it. Amen. Be faithful. If you got to encourage your enemy and love them up, listen to me, do it. I got enemies I did recommendations letter to and find job for, and I know they don't like me. But I still do it. Because you know what? I'm walking in God's power and authority. The minute I look at them and I hear them, they're controlling me. I'm not doing that. The power comes when you can overcome the temptation. That's where power comes from. That's where the power comes from. And like I shared in the morning devotion, Jesus, when he was filled, was led to be tempted. The Holy Spirit helps you in your temptation, but your empowerment comes when you've overcome it. That's why it says, and Jesus came out of the wilderness empowered because he overcome the temptations. What is the thorn in your side? What is that thing that keeps you from serving and worshiping God? Deal with it, because the minute you overcome it, you've got power. Break it down simple. You know, when you've been in a relationship, and you and the person separate. Every time you see them, they just turn your system. You know, someone says, oh God, he turned my system. Listen to me. You're not single. You know why? Because you're still holding on a grudge. When you're single, you've let go of everything and have created a space for genuine love. But if every time somebody passes in front of you and you think, oh God, I remember what he did to me. And what? No, 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 no. You're not ready for the next stage of blessing. You've got to overcome that. You got somebody who've done you wrong and you've not forgiven them. You've got to overcome that, because that's where the power comes. Otherwise, every time sister see me, I still controlling her because she's not forgiven me. So how can I have power? She's just handed her power over to me. But the minute she forgives, she experienced walking out of the desert empowered. Amen. And power comes when you've overcome the thing that easily besets you. That's why Jesus was powerful when he came out and he was empowered, because the temptation of money and of wealth and of this and bread turned the stone into bread. If you fall, you'll gnash your feet against the ground. The devil knew the word. But Jesus overcome, because those were the things that could have led him astray from the purpose God called him to. You want to be empowered? You got to overcome your temptations. Because then you walk in the empowerment of God and you can fulfill your purpose. You notice when David went to fight Goliath, when they gave him all of those things, David said, I've not proven this. I don't want you to come and give me all of these funds. I've not proven it. What I have proven is what my hands can do with a slingshot and a rock. I don't want the way you have fought your battle. I'm going to fight it out. God is calling me to fight this battle. You have to understand what God is saying to you. Each of us, our weapon looks different. Some might be worship, some might be praying, interceding, singing. All of us, our weapons look different. But you see, the thing is, if all of us have got weapons and you stay in your corner fighting, you may not make it. But you see, if all of us come together and fight for Minister Ozier, ain't no way he's going to fail. We've got to understand, God has not put us in this world. While we're separated from the world, we are not to be separated from each other as the body of Christ. And that's what we miss sometimes. It's separation from the world, but not the body of Christ. Whatever God has called you to this morning, do it with diligence, commit yourself, and understand that God will reward you openly what you have done in secret. God bless you. Let us stand in the presence of God. This morning, I don't know what's the little that you have. But if you can be faithful in the little things, the little tasks that God has given you, it's not the big things, you know. It's not about doing great and mighty things, but doing a little thing in a great way. Because it's a little thing that has a greater impact and effect on people's life. Whatever little task you have, do it to the best of your ability, brothers and sisters. And I will not look down on anyone, whether you're a cleaner, you're a cook, whether you pick up garbage, whatever you do, that is God humbling you for purpose. Just do it with humbleness, humility, and do it from your heart. Of love. If you do that, brothers and sisters, then there will be a great call on your life. God is calling you to greatness, but you've got to be faithful in the little. So just where you're standing this morning, you're saying, Lord, I want to be faithful in the little so that I can walk in the much. I want to be faithful in the little, walking in obedience, so that when you call me to the greater, I am prepared, I am equipped. Let us pray. Lord, as we come this morning, we present ourselves as a living sacrifice. Lord, you know everything there is to know about us. There are those who might have been overlooked, those who might have been shunned, those who might have been rejected. But in your eyes, there is value. And so, Lord, forgive us for at some time trying to find our value and our worth and purpose in the world when it is not there. Forgive us, God, for those moments where we've allowed the world to define what happiness and joy and all of that looks like, when the world itself doesn't even know. Forgive us when we've taken our eyes off of you, like Samuel did, and failed to recognize that God is sovereign. Lord, as we come today, we recognize that you are the sovereign God. You're Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and you are absolute. There is no limit. There is no boundary, dear God. You are eternally God. And so, God, as we come, we recognize your sovereignty. We recognize that you're the potter and we are the clay. Can the clay say to the potter, why? No, you are our potter and we are the clay. And so, Lord, this morning, I pray that you will perform a work on our lives where you will mold and shape us. We saw how David was molded and shaped in the field, leading lambs, soon to become king, to lead people. I pray this morning that we understand with a little that you have given us accountability for. Whether it's 1 talent, 2 talents, 4 or 5 talents, may we be faithful in the little, so that we can experience the much. And so, God, as we lift our hands, I pray for purpose, that we would understand your purpose, understand where you have positioned us in the kingdom of God, that we can serve you faithfully, not serve you in our own strength, but serve you under the leading of the Holy Spirit. And so, Lord, we surrender our everything and our all to you. Yes, there are those who condemn and have rejected us, but they don't even know better because they themselves are hurting people, hurting others. May we understand that we are not just called, but we've been chosen and separated, a remnant for such a time as this. Lord, let us run the race with patience. As David had to wait to become king, may we be patient and our eyes always fixed upon you. I pray for pride this morning that precedes a man that fall. But God, that we will humble ourselves and understand what it means to serve others and not just wanting to be served. Those of us in leadership position, may we understand that with leadership comes responsibility and there's a delicacy that comes with it. And so may we understand and be good stewards of those God has placed before us, in our hands and around us, that we can really be the salt and the light that you've called us to. Lord, may we see each other as family, and may we understand that we are separated from the world, but not each other, as the body of Christ. Help us, God, that we can walk according to your purpose and your will. Lord, even as we lift our hands, we pray for those who are sick, those who are here, those who are watching us online, those who are in homes this morning. Lord, it said by your stripes we are healed. And so we pray for those who are laying on the hospital beds this morning, those who are watching this cast live on YouTube. Lord, I pray wherever they are that the presence of God, that the Holy Spirit will touch them, because there is no boundary, east, north, west, or south, that contain the mercies of God. And so, Lord, I pray today for everyone in the midst, whatever the infirmities, whatever sickness or illness, dear God, we pray for all of those persons who are at the fringe of the world's chaos, that today you be the liberator, you be the healer, you be the restorer, you be the one who reconciles them back unto you. Lord, you said, except the Spirit draw them, they will not come. And so we pray for your Spirit not just to dwell in this sanctuary, but it dwells inside of us, that it will draw men to us and we can lead them to you. Help us, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. You may have your seats. Brothers and sisters, we're all called for greatness. But it's just if we are willing to submit and to be humbled before God. Let's put our hands together for the Word of God and the Holy Spirit this morning, because I'm sure we've all received something that we can walk away from. Amen. I know we have some visitors. Can you just stand and just give us your name so that we can acknowledge you by your name? Amen. Come and put your hands together for them.
My name is Queens as well. And I came with Reverend Donna. She invited me with, and I really enjoyed the message of the first word. confirmation.
Yes.
I really enjoyed myself with Deco at home. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Thank you. Amen. It's glory to God. You know that we can come in one place and regardless of where we fellowship, we are still a part of that body of Christ. So thank you so much for gracing us with your presence. And please feel free to come and to worship with us anytime that you're able to do so. Amen. Do we have any other visitors this morning? Okay, nice. Nice to have you. Thanks for coming. Amen. Amen. So let's just put a round of applause that we have some visitors this morning. And I believe God probably just brought you this specific Sunday just to hear these words. I hope the word would have been a blessing unto you. Amen. We'll prepare for the tithes and offering and ask the worship team to come. And under the instruction of the ushers, you will bring up your tithes and offering. Thank you.
Amen. There are a couple ways that you can give, whether that's in person as the usher comes around, or you can give via Zelle or Cash App. I think they'll put that on the screen. There it is. Once you have your tithes and offering in hand, could you stand with us? I'll just bless the offering. Father God, we thank you for what we are about to give. We know that 100% of everything belongs to you, and you have allowed us to have a bit of it so that we can take care of our families, take care of ourselves, and enjoy this life that you have given us, Father God. We thank you, Lord, for providing. We thank you, Lord, for keeping. And we ask you, Lord, that those who may be struggling financially, Lord, that you would make a way, Lord. God, you know every situation. You know every care, and we cast all of our cares on you, knowing that you will care for us. God, bless what we are about to give, multiply it, use it for your glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. You can follow the leading of the usher down the center aisle and around the sides back to your seats.
Be glorified, be glorified, be glorified, be glorified,
be glorified,
be glorified in the heavens, be glorified. Worship the Lord.
Worship the Lord, say.
Worship the Lord.
Worship the Lord in this temple.
Worship the Lord in the temple.
Worship the Lord, say.
Worship the Lord in the earth.
Hallelujah.
Worship the Lord in the heaven.
Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus,
be thou
glorified.
One more time, be glorified.
Jesus, Jesus,
be thou
glorified.
Hallelujah. Bless your name.
Amen.
I think we just have announcements left, and then we'll dismiss. Just our usual announcements. I don't think that we have anything extra today, but just a reminder that each morning, Monday through Friday, we have morning devotions at 5:30 a.m. So you are all welcome to join. I don't know if they have the number on the
Zoom
screen, but you can always get it. I think the number is in the back and the bulletin as well. But it's always a great way to start your morning just before you start your day. So welcome to join us at any time. And I think on Wednesday, we're going to have the usual
Bible
study and prayer at 7:30. Different number, but the usual Zoom call-in number as well. So this week, we will have prayer at 7:30 p.m. on Wednesday. I think that's it.
That's it, yes.
God bless you all. Pastor Kim.
Amen. Can we just stretch forth our hands? We're going to pray for Brother Mighty, who's in some pain right now, even as he sits here. We're going to pray for him. If we can just stand and just stretch forth your hands and let us trust God. I know he would have at some time, I think, did a surgery. You are great, you do miracles so great, there is no one else like you, there is no one else like you, you are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one like you. Come on, let's just stretch our hands. Lord, as we come today, we come not because we must, but because we may. It's a privilege that you've given unto us, that we can come before your throne of grace because of what Christ did on the cross. But even before we got to the cross, Lord, he was beaten with many stripes so that we might be healed. And as your word said, healing is your children's bread. And so, Lord, I pray that today, in this time, in this moment, in this second day, God, that as your son feasts upon the stripes, that indeed it becomes bread and food and nourishment through his bodies. That which was so painfully felt by Christ, may he experience it as healing virtue in his body even now. And so, Lord, we pray right now that the Spirit of God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, God, that you touch every bone, every fiber, every tissue, every ligament, red and white blood cell, every nervous system, the sensory system, the skeletal system, the bones, the marrows. Lord, touch every fiber, liquid, solid, and hair and gas. Touch every component, that which God, that you knitted and you made man from the dust and you breathed life into him. Lord, touch every element that formed this physical body. And Lord, right now we pray for your healing virtue. Complete healing and restoration, the God, in the name of Jesus. That which the surgery would not have been able to do, God, we know that you are able beyond the cause of men. And so, Lord, touch him, heal him, and grant him that honor that he can testify of your goodness. And so we thank you, God, for the work that you are doing even now in his body. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Let us dismiss. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Go with the peace of God. Have a blessed and wonderful week.